So, who was Martha, and why is Martha Corner named after her? Well, her full name was Martha Ann Lindsay. Her original surname was Burke. And for this talk, I will be basing my evidence on some genealogy work previously carried out, available online. The Papers Past website, which is a collection of newspapers which have been scanned from the first 100 years or thereabouts of New Zealand's history, and a Department of Conservation archaeological excavation report, which was for a dig carried out in Chancery Street back in the 1990s. Now, so why am I interested in this? Well, I was looking into the story of Martha for some signage being installed on a street on the corner of Albert Street and Victoria Street West, near Roma Blooms, where you'll see Martha's Corner written on the building at 51, well, Victoria Street West, I should say. Now, and signage was being installed for the City Rail Link streetscape upgrades, which I'm tangentially involved with. And I fell down a rabbit hole for half a day on Papers Past. And I realised actually there's a story here to tell. And it's also a story which shows the richness of life in historical Auckland. And also it shows you how easy it is to find out these things. Honestly, please, people, if there's one thing you can take away from this talk, have a look at Papers Past and just Google for it. And it is better than doom scrolling modern news, let me tell you. You have so much going on out there, and all life's rich pageant is available to you in old newspapers. So I'll start off. So here we are, Martha's Corner. As you might recognize it, the run of shops are still there. And Roma Blooms is on the, as it is now, is on the far right. We're looking up the hill. Up Victoria Street, looking westwards, and the new entrance to the City Rail Link station is being built there as we speak. Now, I'm going to read out her obituary in 1925, as it sets the scene quite nicely, and then we'll get into the details around it. Now, before I go any further, just out of interest, are there any descendants of the Lindsay family here? Ah, thank you. I'm sure you better maybe know more than I do on this. And if there's any corrections, please. We'll have a chance for some questions at the end and find out more. Like I said, this is only a skim of what is out there on the surface, but I'm sure there's a lot more out there in places I haven't yet looked. So, Martha's has a great obituary in 1925 in the Auckland Star. And well, read it out. Mrs. Lindsay dead. Passing of old identity, 55 years a dealer. Mrs. Martha Lindsay, the oldest established second-hand dealer in town, died yesterday. The death of Mrs. Lindsay at the age of 75 removes a very prominent figure. Her name was known not only to the inhabitants of her own district, it was familiar to all walks of life. That she was the oldest second-hand dealer in this city, there is no doubt. She had been in the business for 55 years. She spent 31 of them in a little shop so full of old clothes and knick-knacks of every description in which she died peacefully yesterday morning. Previous to that, she carried out her trade in premises that were situated on the corner opposite the Wellesley Street post office. And prior to that, her home was in Chancery Lane. She was born in this city, and remember, dear, she died the old Auckland with which that there are now left so few human links. She was a witness, for instance, of public hangings of what is now known as Self's Corner at the junction of Queen and Victoria Streets. Well, don't see many of those these days. Where in the 60s, the old jail stood. Mrs. Lindsay was a great old sporter at the races, to use the expression of her daughter. She followed the sport of kings all her life. 50 years ago, she went out to Ellerslie in a dray and paid 4 pence for a drink of water. In later years, she secured the rights to the course at each meeting and sublet refreshment booths. She did the same thing at cattle shows and was a well-known figure in those days, as Mr. Selby is on the course today. She had a licensed booth at Ellerslie in that great year when Nelson won the Auckland Cup. That is going back into the dim beyond, but in the old lady's memory, it was fresh as ever. She attended her final meeting last month when she was present at the complimentary meeting given to the officers and men of the American fleet. Her son Sam was once a fine jockey. When she was a girl, Mrs. Lindsay would walk out to Titirangi to see a friend and then walk into town again. Those who will miss her most are the poor people in her own district. She was a friend to all. They came to her in trouble and she helped them. She always had a bed or meal ready for any who needed them. Returned soldiers knew her well, for she was a great friend to them. She's done many a good turn that nobody but the one for whom she did it knows about, was what a star representative was told this morning. Mrs. Lindsay leaves 4 sons and 1 daughter, 12 grandchildren and 3 great-grandchildren. Her father was Michael Burke, an Irish pugilist, and she used to recount with pride how he once fought a great contest with bare knuckles on the Epsom racecourse. Mrs. Lindsay enjoyed her usual health until Thursday last. On Friday, she was afflicted with a paralytic stroke and died at 8 o'clock yesterday morning. What else do we know? What more can we find out to back up that obituary? Is there more written out there which can be looked at? Well, we start at the beginning of her life. August the 14th, 1852. In Muddy Creek, Titirangi. Now, in those days, property names weren't quite so fancied up by developers, so Muddy Creek was a pretty accurate name for it. And here's a lithograph of it from 1862 from the Auckland Library Heritage Collection. This is now Langholm, which is going to sell a lot more properties than Muddy Creek will. It's not the only place which gets renamed. Eden Park was once known as Cabbage Tree Swamp, for example. So. Now, her parents were from York. Her father was from Yorkshire, and her mother was from Birmingham in England as well. Now, out in Muddy Creek at the time, it was the 1850s. My understanding is it's the end of the logging in this part of West Auckland, that the last vestiges of the quality timber was being hauled out. And soon afterwards, we start seeing the move into farming in this area. Martha was the second child of her parents. She has an older sister, Margaret, who dies as a baby. She also has a youngest brother called John. Now, he's born in 1853, but 1854, he's baptised in Onehunga, and that's where the family moves to when she's quite young. Whilst also living in Onehunga, she has another sister was born, Catherine, who's born in 1858, and also dies as a baby, I mean child. Mortality rates would have been quite high at the time. Now, sometime in between 1852 and 1862, her parents, Michael Burke and Catherine Burke, split up. And soon afterwards, Catherine marries Daniel Townsend. Now, we know this happened sometime before 1862 because Daniel Townsend and Catherine have a son, also called Daniel, in 1862. And this turns up in a court case in 1878 over a dog without a collar, which is found, where he claims that Michael claims he left Catherine in 20 years earlier, and therefore it was not his dog in trouble. So a lot of these things, a lot of these minutiae of life get recorded faithfully in a newspaper. They get, if it's a court case, there's going to be a newspaper article. Now, where do they move to after Onehunga? Well, this is where we get into the Round Chancery Street, which is where we get mentioned in her obituary. So Martha, her mother Catherine, and her stepfather Daniel run a shop in Chancery Street, and this is a view down into that part of Auckland, out towards, well, looking out towards Quay Street and in from what's Albert Park. But this is a later picture taken in 18 from Barrack Hill from 1869. It gives you a bit of an idea about the neighbourhood there. Chancery Street, originally in 1840s, when Auckland was settled by Europeans, was known originally to be a slum. According to the New Zealand Herald in 1841, slygrog shops, receiving houses and skittle grounds are therefore numerous and will continue for many years to come. It was down close to the port. It was pretty rough and ready. By the 1860s, the neighbourhood picks up a little bit more. The street directory published at the time has a lot of manual labourers working there, shoemakers, butchers, fishermen, other tradespeople. There's some small businesses opening as well. There's a couple of hotels and a couple of general dealers and a printer. Now, there's a good chance one of the general dealers could well have been the Townsend, Daniel Townsend, his wife Catherine, and of course Martha. Now, we know a little bit about the shop being run there because there's a fight which occurs in 1867. John O'Neill, a debtor, is called over towards the shop on Chancery Street, whereupon he is assaulted by Catherine and Martha. Martha at this time is only 15. Both Catherine and Martha are fined 20 shillings and costs, or otherwise 7 days imprisonment with hard labour if not paid. There was also counterclaims about who hit first, and it was all got quite messy. I think one of the things which is very common at the time, people really liked to go to the courts to settle any disagreement, any dramas. People would go to the courts on the slightest provocation as a way to settle issues. People didn't feel like they didn't want to keep the law out of it. But people were very keen to get the law involved, and this gets faithfully recorded in the newspapers of the time. So it's an absolute window into life and the issues people have. And if nothing else, it does show you that people's behaviour doesn't really change much over time, and that things don't. Yeah, you'll see on this one. You'll see as you go through on this one. Now, unfortunately, a bit of sadness here. So Martha's surviving sibling John in 1869 dies in Chancery Street. There's a funeral notice published which mentions that Michael, his father, and Martha's father was dead. This wasn't true. Michael is most definitely alive and appears in considerable numbers of court cases around Auckland since then. So here we go. Now, so we're getting moving a bit more into our fun with some of our newspaper and articles there. Now, 1869, age 17, Martha has her first child, a name of Catherine Spencer Burke. Catherine's father was John Spencer. John Spencer was a master mariner, and they were unmarried at the time. But shortly afterwards, in 1870, as a married mother, 18, Martha buys her first shop, and we actually have her down as owning the property, which is unusual for Chancery Lane. Most property there is rented out at this time. So she's doing right there, and she's down on the records as a spinster at the time. So this is on the cadastral records, which trace property ownership and transfer. There's no record of, incidentally, of either of a mother or a stepfather owning property in the area at the time as well. Also, we find an awful lot of petty theft occurs in shops. And so if you have a shop, you're going to appear usually as a witness to it. And in the case we see here, we have the case of larceny on the left, which was someone went for in a bit of a grab and dash for some boots at Martha's shop on Chancery Street. And as you can see, it's Martha Burke, still unmarried at the time. And so it builds up a bit of picture of life in Chancery Lane there. 1871, soon afterwards, well, we know, as I said, her father 2 years later claimed to be dead. Well, he's charged with assaulting his daughter, but due to no marks being seen and it being a first offence, the case is dismissed. And there are other records out there, Michael Burke, is still living around Chancery Lane. He's still selling secondhand goods. He's still in the business, although I can only imagine quite a tense that would be between living around a corner from your ex-wife and her new husband and your your daughter. And there was, in fact, one case which doesn't, which I haven't got clipped out, where Catherine, Martha's mother, attacks her ex-husband with a carving knife. It goes to court, but neither parties turn up, so the case is dismissed. So there's... Anyway, so we also know in 1871 that Martha marries Alfred James Lindsay and takes his surname. So, and he's a labourer born in Auckland, and his father was a horse trainer called Samuel. Now, these names reappear. People like to recycle names. This makes life very difficult tracking people down sometimes in papers, because no one mentions if it's the son or the father who's inevitably getting into trouble with the law. Now, 1871, their son Samuel Alfred is born, so taking his father and his grandfather's names. Now, she must have been quite feisty, because Martha takes a police constable to court in 1872 and accuses him of assault, which is, I think, quite impressive going. So it's recorded down there that I think it was probably a bit of a case of, you know, some man bites dog for newspaper art, for a newspaper journalist, because it's an unusual way around it. Usually it cuts the other direction. People have been charged with assaulting a police officer instead. So it's, and then unusually, for there's a bit of verbatim comments on it. So the assault consisted of being dragged by the arm to the lockup, as described by the complainant, and she'd been well known to the police, but nothing to do with this case. Now, I assume the mention of the assault was probably referring back to the case that happened when she was 15. But there you go. And yes, I like the line about that, just because my husband's a loafer, just because my father's a loafer, I've still got a right to speak to him on the pavement, which is sort of, so I mean, so obviously by that stage, Michael wasn't exactly in the greatest of places, but it's there on record there. But it gives you a bit of a picture of ups and downs of life, and again, how readily people would go to the court. People saw no fear about going to the court over anything, including charging an officer of the law with assault. In 1874, their daughter Martha Ellis Lavinia is born. Interestingly, 1875, we find a bit of... They sell their property in Chancery Street. So Martha and Alfred sell their property up. Alfred applies for a publican's license for the Oddfellows Arms, also in Chancery Street, at the same time. So I wonder if they sold it up to the shop, got some capital from that, and then moved on. I don't know when they moved to shop, when Martha moved to shop 2 on Wellesley Street West, as referred to in her obituary. That's still one of the mysteries out there. We haven't found that out. That's going to involve a lot of searching the records, but it's potentially doable. They have another daughter born in 1877, and unfortunately she dies soon afterwards, and then child mortality there at the time. 1878, son Alfred James Jr. is born. They also have another son in 1880, Daniel Augustus. You'll hear plenty about him shortly. And in 1882, their son Edwin, who's also better known as Albert Edward, is born. So for the interests of keeping things sane, I'll refer to them as Alfred Jr., Daniel, and Albert. Now, we know that by 1886, we've got Alfred Sr., he's... Martha's husband is working as a cab driver and boarding house keeper. So I'm assuming the boarding house he was keeping was Oddfellows Arms. It was acting as a hotel. There was accommodation upstairs as well. So he had several businesses on the go. And again, here, I guess some trouble with some goods being transferred around, and which already had a debt attached to them. So it's not as dissimilar to selling a car, which has got a bank, where there's titles held in a bank, for example. Again, things don't change too much with thinking about the Facebook marketplace scams and difficulties people can get themselves into there. Now, I've often mentioned a little bit on Daniel Augustus. Lindsay, because he's a bit of causes a bit of trouble for the family. So in 1888, Daniel first hits the paper and he gets the birch, age 8. 6 strokes of the birch rod for stealing 4 pairs of braces, along with 3 of it, with 2 of his mates out of there. Soon afterwards, in 1889, so Daniel is probably aged about 9. Alongside his older brother Alfred and younger brother Albert, they break into some local bathhouses, and they steal goods to the value of 15 shillings and 10 pence, which is quite a lot of. This is pretty high value for stuff at the time. And now the youngest of the 3, Albert, gets discharged from custody and gets sent home because he's only 6, bless him. His older brothers were 9 and Daniel was 9 and Alfred was 11 at the time. And again, Daniel's also up in front of the magistrate, Dr. Giles, who sees a lot of Daniel. When he's aged 10, for stealing 1 shilling and 6.5 pence worth of cash out of from a lady's handbag. So that's it. Now he keeps his one up. This is again 1890, and shoplifting by boys is a great. So a number of cricketing caps were stolen from Victoria Arcade, which down on Queen Street, and you see how much they get for that one as well. Lindsay had previously been convicted, was sentenced to 6 strokes and 48 hours hard labour for his actions, aged 11. Now, clearly wasn't being put off by the regular amount of corporal punishment being doled out by the magistrates at this time. And a year later, under the headline, uncontrollable, who is to blame? I mean, clearly this was, obviously, newspapers stoking up fear of a crime, of, juvenile crime. This is nothing new under the sun. We've got it going on here in 1891 here. And again, Dr. Giles, the magistrate, has to handle an application by Martha's husband, Alfred, to commit their son Daniel to a school in Nelson, and basically hand him over to the basic ward of the state, because Mr. Lindsay says the boy's uncontrollable, stays out all night, he can't keep him on the straight and narrow, so hopefully a school in Nelson will sort him out. And Dr. Giles said the boy had been before the court when 8 years of age, been charged with breaking, entering and various larcenies, been sentenced to be flogged 4 times for various offences. Yep. So there you go. So that, in the end, the magistrate makes the order and it requires the Lindsays to pay for the passage of Daniel down to Nelson to go to school. Now, 1891 must have been a bit of a difficult time for Martha. Not only has she got to deal with her son being sent off to industrial school, but her mother, who's living with them at this time, passes away at their property in Wellesley Street East. So we do know from that they're living in Wellesley Street East by 1891. When they move out from Chancery Lane, I'm not really sure. Now, a couple of years later, this is 1893. There's a bit of potentially a mix up in ages on this one down in Christchurch, but it looks like it could well be Daniel Augustus up to his usual tricks, because he would have been 12 and a half, not 16. So it could have been a bit of mix up there. And it looks like he's stealing a quantity of lead from off the roof of a property down there, which again puts him in the South Island. I find it hard to find ever Daniel Lindsay's down there. So it's a good, it's not conclusive, but I'm fairly sure because the age, it's been mixed up on the ages by the newspaper there. Interestingly, that there's another Martha Lindsay causing trouble in Auckland at the time, because in Sutton we have that record there of 1893 that she's not the Martha Lindsay who gave evidence in an assault case. So she's clearly feels like she has enough of a reputation as a secondhand dealer to uphold that she's happy to go to court, but not that on that particular case there. Now this one in 1898 I really like, because she's clearly running a secondhand store, but she's also clearly dealing in the property that comes across her door isn't necessarily has the best provenance, because she appears as a witness in a case of theft from a boarding house. Some woodworking items are stolen from a room, and she ends up buying them from the thief for 2 shillings. Now the items are worth 30 shillings. Now that's usually a sign that these items were fairly hot if the person selling it was willing to accept 2 shillings for items worth considerably more. And the line that's on the bottom from the judge, which was, "His Honour said these dealers should be careful or they were likely to find themselves charged with receiving stolen goods." So that's definitely a bit of a warning out there that we know what's going on here. And if you keep this up too much and it gets too obvious, we will take action there. But yes, when thefts took place, it was noticed there were always secondhand dealers in Auckland who were always ready to purchase the stolen goods. I mean, it's a bit of a warning out there that people knew what was going on. It was that running a secondhand dealer's shop it could be a grey area on this one. Now, we also have more interesting things happening here. Around 1874, we've got this move to Victoria Street West. We do know that now. And by this stage, at the shop, James, Alfred and Daniels are living there. We know that one because they were charged but acquitted of robbing a George Robert Hamilton of a gold ring. Now, the court case establishes that George was in possession of a rather shiny, expensive gold ring at the local pub and had taken advantage of the hospitality there, and after quite a few pints, asked where he could sell the gold ring, and he was pointed in the direction of Martha's secondhand store. It's late at night, he bangs on the door, doesn't get much of an answer. He's had a few beers, so he bangs again and says, "Open up or I'll break your windows." Now, at this point, Alfred and Daniel open the door and go out and proceed get rather violent in protection of the shop. And at some point, the gold ring disappears. And as no conclusive evidence ever ends up in the shop, they're acquitted of the theft. And it gives you a bit of an idea of what it was like out there on the streets of Auckland late at night after around closing time of the pubs and bars. Now, so Daniel is also, let me see, he's also got some things there. In 1900, Daniel has a child out of wedlock, and he's ordered to pay 7 shillings a week and £1.01 costs for that. Next, in 1901, Daniel Lindsay is sentenced to months imprisonment for failing to pay his child maintenance payments. So again, nothing too new under the sun, really, out there. And also in 1901, there's some minor issues of some shop goods on the pavement. We find particularly Constable Montgomery has been a bit of a stickler there, and yes, a quantity of goods were occupying a lot of space on the footpath outside the shops, which had to be moved, so she was convicted and discharged, having promised not to do it again. But I mean, if you think about it, a lot of the shops out there would have had goods on the footpath sprawling out there, so it wouldn't be out of place. But on that, now I'm not entirely. Now I do have a reference here too of a shop catching fire in around 1902. A house actually in Mount Wellington. So she was clearly in a bit of property investment at the time. So she picking up, she had definitely had fingers in quite a lot of pies. Although I can't necessarily pick up much on the Ellerslie racecourse, which of course alluded to in her obituary, but she's clearly, but she's definitely got an astute business person. She's got a lot of things going on there. At the time, it was quite common for women to run boarding houses, own property, things like that. That's actually quite not uncommon. In fact, by the First World War, you'll find that the first apartment buildings in Auckland are being commissioned by women who are traditionally running boarding houses who want to get into the apartment business. So it's not that unusual here. Even though it's, we're looking at a time where you would think that women's rights were limited on property. They weren't. Daniel's back in the paper again in 1902. This time, for some reason, he ends up in the army camp at Te Papapa, down there on Ihunga, and was found in a drunk state outside the canteen, and then gets into a brawl with the one of the quartermasters there. In his defence, he said he was drunk at the time, so you can remember. So yeah, and he gets 1 month's hard labour for that. So I mean, there you go. I mean, that's fairly. It's gets him out of his usual neighbourhood of a city centre. I'm not entirely sure what he's doing down that way, but there you go. Now, we've got Alfred Lindsay. I'm assuming it's Alfred Lindsay Jr. Was fined 10 shillings and 13 shillings costs, which says that money in fair words, back in, what was it, 1906, and that's for furiously riding a horse on Albert Street. Now, furious riding is different from riding fast, as I found out. Fast riding, you get much less fine for it, a couple of shillings. So furious riding is equivalent of sustained loss of control, burnouts. It's basically you're riding around like a real hoon on the streets. It's not just going a bit faster than people would like. You are you're just cutting the corner a bit. This is definitely, from the amount of money they've been fined, that is some seriously bad riding going on. So I mean, this is, again, yep. Yeah, road offences, nothing new under the sun. You could also be done for being in charge of a horse whilst drunk. So again, drink driving, nothing new either. And not a crime I found associated with the Lindsay family, by the way. They didn't get caught anyway. Which is, so there you go. But now, obviously, by 1908 to 1919, and we've got cases of Daniel's definitely running the shop with his mother on Victoria Street. Again, just the usual things. They're witnesses to being handling stolen goods. Basically, they're not being prosecuted, but they're popping up as a witness to the trial. For example, here a coat ended up there at shop. They were just or even offered it. It provides a bit of a regular understanding of who's running the shop and where it is, which is useful for us. Now, Samuel Lindsay, the oldest son, who is referred to as being a jockey of some repute, I don't find much about him until 1912, where it seems, unfortunately, his luck as a jockey runs out, that he ends up, due to various accidents and spate of bad luck, ends up having to apply for bankruptcy. But the description of him of why he's a bankrupt just provides a bit of a eye into his life in terms of what he got up to there, and also about the fact that he also tried to go into he also the movement around the Tasman as well. Samuel tries his luck working in Sydney for a while as a jockey, and then comes back. So people do move across to Australia in search of better employment opportunities before coming back. That's, again, nothing new either. People were moving around quite a bit then. Now, in 1913, Alfred Senior, so that's Martha's husband, he dies, and the funeral procession leaves from 51 Victoria Street for Simon Street Cemetery at the time. So we have that address ties in nicely with 51 Simon Street, Martha's Corner, as we know it today, on the corner of Albert Street and Victoria Street. Not long afterwards, Daniel decides to try his luck at a new job, in a new field. He decides he applies for his license for the to be the publican of the Hobson Hotel. Now, the Hobson Hotel here, this is a photo from the early 1950s, was on the corner of Victoria Street and Hobson Street, it's really hard to picture where it is, but that is basically where Sky City Casino is now. And that, on the other side of Hobson Street, is the Manchester Unity Building, which I believe came down for where TVNZ is now based. So that gives you a bit of a... It's one of these corners of Auckland where it's incredibly hard to, on this angle, to try and picture it and make any connections through to what's there now, because everything in that photo has gone. So he does get his publican license there. Now the family continues connected around this area and also connected to the horses as well. Alfred the son ends up as being involved with a bit of a brawl around an illegal bookies at Ellerslie Racecourse. Now, this is in 1916. Around by this time, my understanding is the only place you could gamble legally was trackside at the totalizer at the tab. Everything else was not legal. So there was obviously place some bets on the side, but obviously if you were a legal bookies, you probably had some muscle to keep because you were carrying a fair bit of cash with you. Anyway, so this a scuffle breaks out down there, and yep, Alfred's there as one of the heavies for the bookie. I don't know what his mother thought about that, considering she was still involved with the racecourse at this time on the committee and with her refreshments, as we found out on her obituary. Now, is it other little strange mentions of things? We've got Mrs. Chapman was instructed to call on Mrs. Martha Lindsay, corner Victoria and Albert Street, on urgent business. Well, I'm not sure what the urgent business was. Maybe she was owed some money to Martha for goods which she had pawned. I don't know, but there's definitely, and that's a little bit of a mystery there, but that was a little private advert taken out in the papers. Again, some more stolen goods keep on occurring. Theft is definitely from retail is definitely a thing back then too. And this is 1917. John Flannery stole some shoes from the shop, tried them on, and wouldn't pay for them and already take them off. So he made a break from it, didn't get very far, and obviously from the sounds of things, was under the influence as well. And the sounds of things also someone had a bit of previous as well, so known to everybody in the area. So now Daniel at the Hobson Hotel continues to get into the papers. 1919, Daniel gets busted for serving after hours. He also gets busted for selling alcohol on Good Friday. Interestingly, represented by Russell McVeigh, a name which we all know quite well in Auckland. But yeah, there he is, which made me smile the connections there. So he was shouldn't be doing that one. And finally, he also gets a divorce in not a particularly, in quite an embarrassing manner. So the newspaper was quite supportive of the actions of his aggrieved wife Cornelia Lindsay, who they've been married happily for three years until he wasn't so happy, and then she managed to, as you said from the evidence there, managed to catch him around town with his niece, and then concealed herself at the pub to see her husband and his niece, enter a bedroom and leave it again in the morning. So that evidence, and with a witness to this who worked at the Hobson Hotel, that was enough for the a decree nisi to be granted by the judge on it. And the newspaper, some successful detective work, was quite a clearly felt that was sort of a was the solid behaviour which should be supported in defence of marriage. So again, divorce not as uncommon as you might think. It's occurring out there, and you did have to get some evidence, but it was still being noted in the paper. Now, again, of 1920, Alfred Jr., the youngest son of Martha, he dies. And in 1925, in September, as mentioned in the obituary, Martha herself dies. Now, Martha's buried at Simmons Street Cemetery, and unfortunately, she was buried in the Roman Catholic section, which goes to indicate this, yet her father, Michael Burke, was probably, although of Yorkshire, was probably of Irish background. Now, they as a Roman Catholic, she was unfortunately reinterred during the motorway construction in 1960. And so alongside her husband and her daughter Marianne, she was reinterred in the Catholic common vault in what remains of Simmons Street Cemetery post the motorway going through there. But I quite like this extract here. So Martha is renowned enough at the Ellerslie Racecourse to have a mention not only in the obituaries column but also in the turf section of the Auckland Star, which I think takes some doing, because I mean you've got to be sort of pretty well known at this time to be mentioned in both sections there. So this is quite a nice article about her, that she was always involved at the course. Again, it backs up the things around her in the obituary around owning the licenses and the rights of the course and the subletting the refreshment booths and things like that. So, again, being present at the last at the complimentary meeting given to the officers and the men of the American fleet. And this is the American fleet arriving in 1925. So in 1908, the American Navy that circumnavigates the world under President Roosevelt, and it calls in a lot of places. It's known as the Great White Fleet, and it's basically an expression of America is out there as a world power for the first time. And it does it the second time round in 1925 and calls into Auckland. So here they are. So I thought it was we don't have many photos connected to out there that I can find connected to the family on public record. So I thought it was a good enough mention as ever that she, although she was a secondhand dealer, she was connected to these big world events through the circle she was mixing in and the connections she had. And bear in mind, of course, at the time drinking horses and gambling were probably the tab of your main sources of entertainment. So it was rugby. So it was quite a lot of. So yeah, she was definitely had, through her connections at the track, she had a lot of fingers in many pies and moved in a lot of circles there. So after she dies, well, the shop is sold not long afterwards. We find that the estate is up there, City Freehold. I assume that's the shop. The dwelling section could be frontage to Cameron Place, Victoria Street West. Yep. So that gives you a bit of an idea around she was still there. And that's for the rest of the on other news. I mean, so Daniel still keeps brushes with the law. He's knocked a few years off his age in 1935, but he was running a legal gambling house during the Depression, and he doesn't get in defence, and the court seems fairly lenient about it, but obviously noted that he had not been in front of the court previously, which I think, as we all know, is definitely not the case. I mean, but I'm assuming that no one was quite searching the old record books from 40 years earlier when he was engaged in his first crime spree in Auckland as a child. Now, What happened? Now, since then, the shop was restored in the 1970s and by Thomas Leslie Harvey, best known as Les Harvey. Les Harvey was responsible for a lot of the works around Parnell Village. He developed a lot of the older shops there, restored them, let them out, created the sort of the Parnell that we know now. And also his family owned the run of shops until fairly recently, which number 51 of Victoria Street West, now where Roma Blooms is, that was part of that, of his property there. I think I suspect he named the shop Martha's Corner after the history of the property and the reputation that Martha still had in the neighbourhood even 50 years after she had died. And he wanted to make to commemorate her, but also to make a feature of the place, to try and create an understanding of it as a place to be and place to go, give it a bit of identity there. So I think there's some things to take away from this talk. It would be that the clickbait really isn't new, first off. That crime sells papers, names sell papers, and if you sell papers, you can sell advertising space, and that's how you keep a newspaper running. Again, not too dissimilar to how the media commercially works today. I think it's also important to know children don't need TikTok to go on crime sprees. They can do it very well themselves without any modern distractions, as we've seen there. And harsh interventions don't seem to put you on the straight and narrow, based on the number of times Daniel got flogged as a child. Now, I think the thing is that most of it gets written down and is easy to found out there. History's only written records are only used to a limited number of people. Will only record certain things. It record the bad things happening, or it always record the good things happening. But particularly in case of the media, we don't always have these events out there. Furthermore, they're usually skewed towards people who have money. So to find the stories out of people who are everyday people is always harder out there. Also, things aren't always written down right as well. Just because it's written down doesn't mean it's always true. There's a few dates which seem slightly out on her obituary. The obituary also, for example, misses out her first daughter. And in fact, there's a correction published a few days later saying, actually, we missed a daughter and her family. Oops. So there you go. I mean, there's definitely further research out there, which I didn't carry out, which could be done to dive deeper to other records out there, such as marriage records. Property cadastrals are a very useful tool in New Zealand. We've got very good property records, who buys what, transfers when, which are phenomenally detailed and can be a bit awkward to use, but I would recommend them too. And again, one thing I haven't looked at, which I'm sure is out there somewhere, are the minutes from LSE Racecourse, which I'm sure would be absolutely fantastic. I would hope it would have lots of information about the everyday running of the racecourse and how Martha would have been involved in it, potentially, if she was on a committee. So there's definitely unknowns out there. There's a whole heap of information that I would love, that could be followed up on. And I think it just gives you an understanding that this is out there for a notable person in the city, but this is out there for anyone who has relatives in 19th century Auckland. It's there. It's a really simple search away, and just papers past is a wonderful tool. You can, all these extracts have been scanned and they've been turned into text as well, so you can search for words on them. So you can just put a keyword in, like on Google, and it will just search all the history newspapers of the country. You can change your times on it, you can change your areas of the country you're interested in, but you can have a look and find out a lot more. And honestly, it's an amazing tool, and I urge you all to have a look at it.
I'm just curious, you mentioned that Martha took a police constable to court. What happened thereafter?
Well, the final recording is there wasn't really limited evidence of anything on it, and I believe it sort of fizzled out. There was I think charges weren't pushed any further, no costs were awarded on it. It just, it, there wasn't, the policeman was not found guilty of assault, funny enough, but it was a, but the fact that still she tried it, I think, is quite a, is quite a sign. She was pretty headstrong at that point and wasn't going to take anything from anybody.
Just a quick factual question. That photograph of the Hobson Hotel, yep, it didn't have a reference. Where did that come from?
Yep. Okay. So reference to that one. That one was, I think that one, is it? I may note that. One there. See that one. That's the Doug Marsh collection in Auckland Libraries online.
The
Doug Marsh collection.
Doug Marsh. Right, right. Thank you for that. Just to comment on when that was demolished. I'm sure it would have been right at the end of the 70s or beginning of the 80s. There was also the City Hotel across the road that was demolished about the same time.
Yep. Yeah.
Thanks.
I'm going to make a quick spot, Dan. One source which also illuminates the history of crime is the police gazettes, which are on Ancestry. So while you were speaking, yes, I had a quick search in those, and the Lindsay sons turn up a lot in those, although interestingly, Martha Lindsay does not.
No.
Also, I took a look and found her will, as it's old enough to be digitized on Ancestry, and she was worth £1,415 at the time of her death, which I checked on RBNZ is about $160,000 in today's money.
Much, yeah, there's also a bit of trouble with the will, because the right of the will conflates the names of two of her granddaughters as one name, and it then has to be sorted out in court as well. So,